Good morning, Miranda. Today we are going to discuss about endodontic regression in edibles. So, an old axiom in endodontics says what you remove from the root canals is more important than what you place back. And we shape the canal with instruments, but we really clean the canal with evidence, according to Baumgartner and Nader. So, coming to endodontic irrigants, the main four goals of irrigation are lavage of debris, tissue dissolution, antibacterial action, and lubrication. And what are the ideal requirements of a root canal? To be a root canal irrigant, the irrigant must be a gross debridement, it should have a property of gross debridement. The dissoluting or dissolution of the organic debris present in the root canal. And it should effectively flush out inorganic debris and dentinal shavings. So it must have an adequate flow. It should flow into the root canal to remove the debris and dentinal shavings. It should have lubricant action or lubricating action. And it must eliminate the microorganisms, so it must possess the property of antibacterial efficacy. And it must be a non-toxic material. It should not provoke or initiate any reaction in the root canal or in the periapical region. And it should be economical. And it should have a capacity to remove the smear layer. But still, it is a debate, because removal of smear layer will help to deeper penetration of root canal sealers. That is according to one part of the endodontist. But in the other part is still arguing or supporting that the smear layer presence is a bit helpful in the case of binding with the sealer or etc. So there is a controversy still. Most of the studies are focusing on the removal of smear layers to give a more deeper penetration of the root canal sealers into the dentinal wall. And it should also prevent the formation of smear layer during instrumentation, or it have the property of dissolving it if it later once formed. And it should have a low surface tension so that it can easily flow into the inaccessible areas like isthmus, lateral canals, and accessory canals. And it should effectively sterilize or disinfect the root canal. So these are the ideal requirements of a root canal. And moreover, we should remember a few more points, that it should not weaken the tooth structure, and also it should be easy to use. It should not have possess any complex instruments or mechanism to drop inside the root canal. So easy to use, and also it should have an adequate shelf life to store. That's why it being also helpful in economical way also. In addition to these non-caustic to the periodontal tissues especially, and have a little potential to cause any anaphylactic reaction. These are the main ideal requirements, and also additional requirements to be an efficient root canal irrigant. We move on to the factors that modify the activity of irrigating solution. What are these factors? Let us find out what are the factors. First one is the concentration. Many studies have shown that though tissue dissolving ability of sodium hypochlorite increases linearly with the concentration, but it is preferred to use at a lower concentration because of its cytotoxic effect. You all know how cytotoxic is the sodium hypochlorite when it enters or touches the tissues, soft tissues, periodontal tissues, periapical tissues. So definitely we must use the hypochlorite in a lower concentration. And next comes a contact. To remember that if the irrigant must be an effective use, it should have, if it is give an effective use, it must be in contact with the substrate. Substrate means organic tissue, that's pulp tissue or microorganisms. So then canals are sufficiently enlarged with the endodontic instruments. Irrigate can be deposited directly in the apical area with a fine irrigating needle, syringes or needles to increase its effect. If it goes up to the apical throat, it have a higher efficacy. So contact is a main point here. If you don't prepare the canal well, at least to a 40 size one, the irrigant can't go deeper into the canal, that is up to apical throat, it can't reach the apical throat. Third one is the presence of organic tissue. The presence of organic tissue decreases the effectiveness of all intracanal medicaments. So after irrigation, after BMP, that is cleaning and shaping, you will place in medicament, right? So if you don't remove those organic tissues before you place in medicament, definitely it affects the efficacy of the medicament. It decreases its efficacy. So no use of placing any intracanal medicament after your BMP. The protein content of organic tissue form a coagulate when it reacts with the medicament. And this coagulant serves as barrier to prevent the further penetration of medicament, thus limiting its effectiveness. So be sure that you remove all the organic tissue by use of these irrigants. And fourth one is the quantity of irrigant used. The quantity of irrigant used is directly related to its ability to remove the debris from the canal. The hypochlorite removes the organic tissue or debris very fastly because it's having a tissue dissolving ability or property. When it comes to saline and other irrigants, it varies. It takes some time. So based on this, you must select the quantity of the irrigant. And the gauze of irrigating needle. 27 or 28 gauze needle is preferred as it can go deeper into the canal, that is beyond your middle third, for better delivery and debridement action. So it must reach your apical third of the canal. So that's our motto. So you can use 27 or 28 gauze for that. And surface tension of the irrigant. So lower surface tension of an irrigant increases its wettability and hence better penetration in the narrow areas for effective debridement. And temperature of the irrigant, as the temperature increases, its efficacy increases. That's why they will preheat the hypochlorite for effective use as an irrigant. And frequency of irrigation, copious irrigation is needed because more irrigation causes better debridement, and each time a fresh potent irrigant plays an action of removing the debris or killing the microorganisms, etc. Coming to canal diameter, wider the canal, better is the debridement and debridement action of the irrigant. Age of the irrigant, definitely it plays an important role. If it possesses a good shelf life, the irrigant is really very useful to us. But always remember, freshly prepared solutions are more efficient than an older one. Coming to types of endodontic irrigants, under this we have chemical and natural. Under chemical, we have tissue dissolving, under which sodium hypochlorite and chlorine oxide we have. And antibacterial agents like bactericidal example chlorhexidine and bacteriostatic example MTAD. And chelating agents, third one is chelating agents, under which we have mild pH example HEBP, and with the agents with a strong pH we have EDTA. Under natural agents, we have antibacterial agents like green tea, triphala, etc. So these are the other, these are just types of endodontic irrigants. We move on to the sodium hypochlorite. Before that, normal saline we'll discuss later. First is sodium hypochlorite. So it's first used by Semmelweis in 1847 as a hand disinfectant. And Dakin used 0.5% of hypochlorite solution for irrigating the wounds of soldiers. That's why it's named after him, that's as Dakin solution. beside being its wide spectrum, it is sporicidal, it has a tissue dissolving property, and due to these properties, Coolidge suggested the use of hypochlorite as endodontic irrigant from 1919. So its availability, it is available as unbuffered solution at pH level at concentration 0.5% to 5% or 5.25%. But mostly commonly used concentration is 2.5% solution of hypochlorite. So coming to mechanism of action, at body temperature, the reactive chloride in aqueous solution exists in two forms, that is hypochlorous acid, HOCl, and hypochlorite, that is OCl, depending on its pH or the pH of the solution. And coming with contact with the organic tissues, it forms glycerol and fatty acids, fatty acid salts, that is called a saponification reaction, resulting in surface tension of the solution. And it causes amino acid neutralization reaction, resulting in formation of salt and water. So here pH decreases due to release of the hydroxyl ions. So when hypochlorous acid, HOCl, comes in contact with organic tissue, it releases chlorine, which combines with amino acids, forming chloramines. This is chloramination reaction between chlorine and amino acids, causes interference in the cell metabolism of the bacteria or microorganisms. So these are the three reactions that occur in the presence of organic tissues, leading to tissue dissolution and antibacterial effect. So what are the three? Saponification reaction and neutralization reaction. Third one is your chloramination reaction. So in saponification, you can see it forms glycerol and fatty acids, fatty acid salts. In neutralization, it causes amino acid neutralization, which results in the formation of salt and water. And in chloramination reaction, hypochlorous acid comes in contact with organic tissue, releasing chlorine, which combines with amino acid to form chloramine. This explains the tissue dissolving property of hypochlorite and also its antibacterial efficacy. And remember, always if you increase the temperature of hypochlorite, its action, that is tissue dissolving and also antibacterial efficacy, increases. So there are many methods to increase the efficacy of sodium hypochlorite. How they have done? By increasing the volume of solution and heating the solution between 60 to 70 degrees centigrade, and also they increased by the time of contact. So antimicrobial effectiveness of hypochlorite is directly related to its contact time within the canal. So more the time it is in the contact with the tissues or the canal, more its efficacy of antibacterial. And if you increase its temperature by 25 degrees centigrade, it enhances its efficacy by the factor of 100. So one should be careful that you should not overheat the solution, because this can cause the breakdown of sodium hypochlorite constituents and they cause damage of the solution. And also pH, how can you, if hypochlorite is diluted, its tissue dissolving property definitely decreases. So remember, HOCl is stronger oxidant than hypochlorite ion, which is responsible for strong chlorination, oxidizing action, and tissue dissolution. So this dissolution or dissociation of HOCl to OCl depends on the pH of the solution. So at pH 10, OCl form exists, and at pH 4.5, HOCl form dominates. So the antibacterial property of hypochlorite are more in acidic pH. This you must remember. And also, how can you decrease the efficacy? By decreasing, decrease its efficacy by because of the storage time, and also chemical agents, the contact with the chemical agents like EDTA. So what are the precautions taken to be used by using the hypochlorite? So we already discussed this factors. So what are the precautions? It is important to remember that though sodium hypochlorite is non-toxic during intracanal use, but 5.25% of hypochlorite can cause serious damage to the tissue if injected periapically. So you must take all the care that hypochlorite should not go beyond your periapex. If sodium hypochlorite gets extruded into periapical tissues, it can cause excruciating pain, periapical bleeding, and also swelling. And also remember, it's not the choice of an irrigant in the case of apexification procedures, because already the apex is very wide there. It's open apex. So you must not use hypochlorite in such cases. And also you must use rubber dam. You must isolate the tooth and also the buccal part of the tissues from the exposure or from the contact with the hypochlorite, and also gingiva surrounding the tissue, I mean tooth. Definitely you must isolate this soft tissues to not to come in contact with the hypochlorite by using during BMP. So as potential for spread of infection is related to the tissue destruction, medication like antibiotics, analgesics, antihistamines should be prescribed accordingly. So in addition to this, if it is gone beyond the apex and the patient is feeling excruciating pain and swelling, reassure the patient, and this is a very prime consideration, and also put him on antibiotics, antihistamine and analgesic. But better is that prevention is better than cure. So to avoid accidental extrusion of hypochlorite, we must take all the precautions, especially in the case of large apical openings. It has many advantages. These are all accidents or incidents of hypochlorite. So use of rubber dam to prevent contact with the oral tissues. Avoidance of excessive pressure with intracranial application using the syringe. Never force the syringe, piston of the syringe. Slowly you must deliver the liquid or hypochlorite into the canal from the syringe. If the syringe gets binded to the dentin walls, the material should never be injected or it may lead to an hypochlorite incident. We must remove the syringe slowly. Don't deliver the solution like that. And 1 ml of the solution should be injected over a period of 1 minute, slowly and cautiously. So 1 ml in 1 minute. So before going to next chlorhexidine, the advantages of this hypochlorite are it can cause dissolution, tissue dissolution, remove organic portion of the dentin for a deeper penetration of medicament, and it can remove the biofilm. It causes dissolution of pulp and necrotic tissue. It shows antibacterial and bleaching action. It causes lubrication of the canals and is economical and easily available. On the disadvantages, because of its high surface tension, its ability to wet the dentin is less. And definitely if it extrudes the periapic, if it extrudes periapical, it can cause irritation to the tissue and tissue damage, resulting in tissue damage. If it comes contact, it causes inflammation of gingiva because of its caustic nature. It can bleach your clothes, the aprons, if it spills on your apron or clothes. So, and also it has a bad odor and taste, and the vapors can irritate your eyes. So it can be corrosive of your stainless steel instruments. It is unable to remove inorganic components or smear layer, and long time of contact with the dentin has determined its effect on flexural strength of the dentin. So detrimental to the dentin if there is a long time contact with a root canal wall or dentin. Yeah, we'll move on to hydrogen peroxide. It's a clear, odorless liquid, mainly 3% of solution of hydrogen peroxide is used as an irrigating agent in endodontics. So its mechanism, it's highly unstable and easily decomposed by heat and light. it rapidly dissociates into H2O and O, that is nascent oxygen and water. On coming in contact with the tissue, enzymes catalyze and peroxidase. The nascent oxygen is liberated, produces the bactericidal effect. But this effect is transient and diminishes in the presence of organic debris. And also it causes oxidation of bacterial sulfhydryl group of enzymes and thus interferes with the bacterial metabolism. Rapid release of nascent oxygen on contact with organic tissue results in effervescence of bubbles, formation of bubbles or bubbling action, which is thought to aid in mechanical debridement by dislodging particles of necrotic tissue and dentinal debris and floating them to the surface. That is, it removes it, it comes to the coronal part of the canal. So it is mainly indicated in mandibular teeth because of this bubbling or effervescence property of peroxide, and thought to lift the debris from the canal easily. And it also possesses the disinfecting property, and the nascent oxygen liberated also destroys anaerobic bacteria from teeth with periapical lesions. And what are these uses? Being less effective as a solvent, hydrogen peroxide is less damaging to periapical tissues when compared to hypochlorite. Therefore, when procedural accidents have caused either root of flow perforations or when apical constructions have been destroyed, it is a preferred irrigant in such cases. And in such cases, hypochlorite is we should avoid hypochlorite in such incidences. But if you force the irrigant beyond the canal confines, especially under pressure, it can lead to tissue injury and acute symptoms like pain and swelling. So precautions, definitely you must avoid the contact with oral tissues because it's a bleaching agent also, and pressure injection should be avoided. Since nascent oxygen may remain after access closure, it can build up pressure and causes severe pain. So in such point, you have to use hypochlorite at the end of the procedure to react with the remaining part of the hydrogen peroxide. So the combination of sodium hypochlorite and hydrogen peroxide, this procedure is called SWEC and Hadson, introduced by SWEC and Hadson. So a reducing agent and an oxidizing agent is said to produce a greater cleansing effect and effervescence. That's why these two are combined. And this use is strongly recommended for irrigating teeth that have been left open for drainage. If you give an open dressing, in such cases you can use this. It's effective in dislodging the food particles as well as debris, because it's having antibacterial properties. So the disadvantage is antibacterial properties are inhibited. So it's not, it's purely physical debriding effect. So you can use in the case of suppose an access cavity is done long back and patient has not been reported to the department and has come after 1 month, where his access is opened, where the temporary restoration is lost. This combination will help to remove the debris and particles that are blocked the access cavity. That's it. This is not because the antibacterial properties are inhibited, you can't use it as a effective irrigant while cleaning and shaping. Coming to chelating agents, the chelating agent is defined as a chemical which combines with a metal to form chelate. Chelating agents were introduced in 1957 into dentistry for aid in preparation of narrow and tortuous canals to soften the canal dentin and to increase its dentinal permeability by removing the smear layer. And the word chelate means to clog. As a chelating agent has the ability to combine with the ions, metallic ions, and it can inactivate it very easily. So the chelating agents that are used in dentistry are EDTA, RC prep, that's root canal prep, EDTA, Largel Ultra, Tubulicid Plus, Salvisol, and 5-Ease. Coming to EDTA is the most commonly used chelating agent of all the mentioned above chelating agents. It was introduced in by Nygaard and Oxby for cleaning shape and shaping of the canals. It contains four acetic acid groups attached to the ethylene diamine. EDTA is relatively non-toxic and slightly irritating in weak solutions. Effect of EDTA on dentin depends upon its concentration and duration of contact with the dentin. Definitely. And the mode of action, as I said, it inhibits the growth of bacteria and ultimately destroys them by starvation, because EDTA chelates with the metallic ions in medium, and these ions are needed for growth of microorganisms. So that's why it destroys and keep the microorganisms under starvation. EDTA has self-limiting action. It forms a stable bond with calcium and dissolves dentin. But when all the chelating ions are reacted, an equilibrium is reached, which prevents further dissolution. So for EDTA, removes mere layer with 1 minute of exposure, and this effect doubles after 15 minutes. So further increase in time of contact does not increase the demineralization effect. Kant and Zipper found that increase in contact time along with the concentration from 10 to 17% and pH 7.5 to 9 has shown an increase in dentin demineralization. So it has a disodium salt of EDTA, 17 grams in distilled water, and 5 parts of solutes in the form of OH2 in 9.25 ml. So EDTA is a 15% solution of EDTA is available for us. So where its pH is 7.3, this sounds affects partial demineralization of dentin to a depth of 20 to 30 microns for 5 minutes. As I said, if you use 1 minute, then it can remove the smear layer, which doubles after 15 minutes. So the extent of demineralization effect is directly proportional to the exposure time, that is contact period. So when used in conjunction with hypochlorite rinse, there is an effective removal of smear layer formed during instrumentation. So under this we have RC prep. So it consists of 10% of urea peroxide, 15% of EDTA and glycol in an ointment base. The presence of glycol makes it as a lubricant and coats the instrument, which facilitates the instrument movement within the canal. So it functions both as chelating agent and irrigant. In the presence of hypochlorite form, it functions as an oxygenating agent, which produces bubbles that loosen and help the debris to flow out of the canal or dentin and tubules. So very effective in softening the calcified dentin. That's why we use regularly in the case of calcified canals. So having pH of 2, it can be highly acidic. The concomitant usage of hypochlorite neutralizes the acidic RC prep. So the advantage is, not only it has the same action of hydrogen peroxide, it also effective in presence of lead. Disadvantage is greater leakage, same as EDTA. EDTAC, it's commercially available as 15% solution and pH of 7.3 under the name of EDTAC. And because it contains cetablon, which is a quaternary ammonium compound, added due to its disinfecting property. It reduces the contact angle of EDTA when placed on the dental surface and thus enhances its cleaning efficacy. And EDTAC is it's a buffer to neutral pH reacts with the smear layer. So both the tightly bound smear layer and superficial smear layer can be removed with the help of this. And the activator is again hypochlorite. And it has a greater inflammatory potential and tissues, which is a disadvantage for this. REDTA is 17% EDTA is combined with cetrimide, which is cetyl trimethylene ammonium bromide, which is mainly added to reduce the hypertension, surface tension. And also increases its penetration. So this, I mean, one more form is Lashel Ultra. It consists of 15% EDTA solution as disodium salt, cetrimide and sodium hydroxide, which in which the case the pH is adjusted to 7.4. Cupulicid Plus, it consists of amphoteric and benzalkylum chloride, disodium EDTA hydroxide and phosphate buffered solution and distilled water. Salvizol, it's a chelating agent containing N and decamethylene, and it has a broad antimicrobial spectrum and at a low general toxicity, and it has a low surface tension which aids in removal of smear layer. It's very active against gram-positive and gram-negative microorganisms and even fungi also.